Welcome to the Virtual Center for the Study of the Constitution and Civic Responsibility, an ongoing inquiry into American political origins and evolving institutions. The executive director of the Virtual Center is Dr. Bill Obrien. He's also your host for this continuing conversation. Here he is now, Dr. Bill Obrien.
Well, thank you, Agnes, and welcome to this Tuesday edition of the Virtual Center for Study of the Constitution and Civic Responsibility. Today is Tuesday, the 22nd day of January in the year 2019. It is a pleasure to be with you on this, our second day of broadcasting. And I mentioned that because I'm afraid that we're not going to be able to do a live program tomorrow. I do have an appointment scheduled just prior to the time that we're due to start our when we start our program. So I know chances are very, very good that I'm not going to be back in time to do the program tomorrow. So I think I mentioned it to Agnes before we went on the air, and I think she's going to basically put in a previous program. I'm kind of responsible for making sure that enough people in the community get an opportunity to complete a needs assessment for healthcare services. I'm on the board at the local hospital here, and as a not-for-profit public institution, the hospital has a responsibility every 3 years to do a needs assessment of the community in order to give the community an opportunity to rate the hospital and give the hospital an opportunity to readjust its services in order to meet the needs of the community. And the board that I've been on for 19 years now has very the same mission. In other words, to promote constant interaction between the hospital and the community it serves, so that the hospital is maximizing its resources and the community is getting maximum benefit from the hospital. So that's what this needs assessment is about. And Agnes and I were chatting about this before we went on the air today. And I have an appointment tomorrow to administer the survey to people who are showing up at the food pantry here for free lunch. And I really believe that the input on healthcare needs from people who are eligible for free lunches would be invaluable to the community and to the hospital. So my appointment is for tomorrow. And so I don't think I'm going to be back in time to do the program. But on the other hand, I feel positive about it because I think the reason that I'm not able to do a program tomorrow, I believe is a good one. It's a worthy one. And so I'm not as uncomfortable about missing the program tomorrow as I am for reasons that don't have any saving grace to them, as it were. So I feel very good about this. So we'll have a repeat program tomorrow. But the weather has improved significantly. The sun is shining and the temperature has warmed up. I think that cold blast from the north has finally begun to dissipate, although there's another one coming toward the end of the week as well. So I don't think we're going to be able to escape for too long. I mentioned it to Agnes and she kind of laughed a little bit. I've got a pot full of stuff today. So, and given the fact that I'm not going to be able to do a live program tomorrow, I'm going to try to touch a number of bases today. And I hope that, that at the end of the day, that it's a valuable, expense of your time. We've got 2 hours, and I'm hoping that you'll be able to stay with us for as much of that 2 hours as possible. And there's a lot of material today. I'm just hoping that at the end of it all that you'll agree that it was worth your time. I hope so. I'll do the very best I can to make sure that that's true. If you'd like to contact us and call in on the program and come on the air and share your thoughts or concerns or suggestions or whatever – about the program or about the news of the issues of the day, as we've been dealing with them here at the Virtual Center, I would love to hear from you. I know our other listeners would as well. We have two phone numbers, either one of which will get you into the studio. Agnes is there today, and she will get you on the air immediately. Both phone numbers have the same area code, and that is 304, area code 304. And the first number is 304-574-8178. That's 304-574-8178. The second number, same area code, 304-640-2829. 304-640-2829. If you'd like to send a communique directly to me, you can do it in two ways. You can either send me an email, or you can contact me through our Facebook page. If you're more comfortable sending an email, then let me give you my email address. It is waobrien, O-B-R-I-E-N, 906, at gmail.com. That's waobrien, 906, at gmail.com. If you prefer to communicate with me directly through our Facebook page, then that's easy as well. Just go to Facebook, facebook.com. That'll get you to the homepage. And at the top of the homepage, there's a search box. And if you type in the Virtual Center for Study of the Constitution in that search box, you'll be onto our Facebook page. And you'll see a number of postings there. And if you go to the end of a particular posting, every posting on there has this. At the end of each posting, there are two links. There's a share link and a comment link. If you click on the share link, it sends that posting to all your friends on your Facebook page, on your Facebook account. If you click on the comment link, it gives you an opportunity to make a comment that comes directly to me. It can be about that posting, but it doesn't necessarily have to be. It can be about something related to the program. The issue is, we would love to hear from you, and we have three different ways that we can make that you can make that happen. So whichever way is the most comfortable for you will be great with us. Either call in and come on the air directly, or communicate with me directly, either by email or through our Facebook page. There are a number of issues. I think, obviously, the shutdown continues to go on. And if I'm not mistaken, so also does the Los Angeles teachers strike. And we haven't mentioned that yet. But Los Angeles teachers have been on strike since last week. And I think it's very important that we pay attention, not only because it involves more than 30,000 teachers striking and 500,000 children either going without any instruction at all or having rather inferior instruction from substitutes who are trying to maintain the school system so that the school people can claim that it's open even though there's not a whole lot of instruction going on. I know a lot of people who are opposed to strikes and opposed to unions and opposed to teacher action in this kind of thing will focus on the fact that salary is one of the objectives or one of the issues behind this strike. But I would call your attention to the fact that there are several other issues that really are motivating this strike. One of them is class size, because obviously as any education institution seeks to save money in delivering its services, the easiest, most obvious way to do that is to just increase class size, which means you're serving more kids in fewer classes, which reduces instructional delivery expenses significantly. And so these teachers are claiming that their classes have become too large for them to do an effective job of teaching. Having been in the classroom myself, I can attest to that. I think I mentioned here on the Virtual Center that last year I was given a history class, college level, with 83 students in it. You do the best you can, but you can't do an effective job in terms of instruction. And there's one area, and I didn't even think about going into, but now here I am right to it, so I'll mention it as well. When you have that many students in a class, the whole process becomes much more impersonal, too impersonal. I think the effectiveness of teaching is dependent to a large extent on the ability of the instructor and students to develop or establish a rapport, a comfort level, if you will. Last week, David Brooks, we spent quite a bit of time yesterday on an article by David Brooks. But last week, and I hadn't even thought of intended to mention this at all. But he wrote an article on teaching. And David Brooks was teaching a seminar at Yale University. Obviously, he writes for the New York Times, but Yale is in New Haven, Connecticut, which is less than an hour drive from New York City. So he was teaching a seminar at Yale University. And so he was operating in large part from his own personal experience. But he cited a lot of research data to back up his thesis. And his thesis was that there's an element of genuine affection, of love, if you will, that really drives the effectiveness of the teaching experience. That there needs to be an emotional connection between students and instructors. And David Brooks mentions, and I'm going from memory now because it's been more than a week since I read this article, but he cites a personal experience in his own seminar. And he never explained what the issue was. But he was telling his class one day that he was going to be unable to meet his office hours that particular week because he was having some personal issues. He never explained what those were. But that a close friend of him, a friend of his, had offered to come and help him work through the personal issues that he had. And because he had an appointment with this friend to address his own personal situation, he was going to be unable to keep his office hours that particular week. And David Brooks said he mentioned that just to explain to students why he wouldn't be in his office at the scheduled time. But he pointed out that when that class ended in the next couple of days, 15 different students in that group, in that class, sent him personal emails and expressed concern about his personal issues, whatever they would be. And Brooks pointed out that for the rest of the term, that class was totally different. The demeanor within the classroom was totally different. Students were much more willing to participate actively in the class. The interaction between him, the instructor, David Brooks, and the students was much closer and much less formal. And Brooks commented that of all the classes over the years that he had taught, that turned out to be the most effective. And the only thing that made that class different from any of the previous ones, he mentioned, was the fact that he had exposed himself, as it were, as having personal issues to these students. And he was led to believe, and he collected a lot of data, research data, to back this up, that the fact that the impersonal instructor in front of the classroom to most students had suddenly lifted the veil and revealed the fact that he was a real person with problems like everybody else. And Brooks surmised that once students saw that, they began to appreciate the fact that they were dealing not with a credentialed professor who was aloof and distant, kind of the enemy, but rather this was a person just like they were, who had problems just like they do. And suddenly it created a togetherness within that class between instructor and student that hadn't been there before. And then Brooks cited a lot of research data to back up the fact that effective teaching requires that. I had a class last year, as I mentioned, with 83 students in it. The first day of class, I read the class roll to take attendance. It took me 35 minutes to take attendance in a class that was only scheduled to meet 50 minutes. So it dawned on me, and I shared it immediately with the students, I can't do this every class. If I do, we won't have a class. So therefore, what I went to was a sign-in sheet. But I realized that if all students do is sign their name to let me know that they were there, then that means that I was never going to be able to get to know the students in my own class. I wasn't even going to be able to recognize their names. So that if a student made a comment or asked a question in class, I couldn't even talk to that student by name. It creates a distance, a sense of impersonal relationship between instructor and student, which affects the quality of the instruction. And I felt it through the whole semester. I felt that students really didn't know me and I didn't know them. In fact, I apologized to them because I told them if I see them on the street and recognize them as being a student in my class, I will acknowledge them, but I won't be able to use your name because I won't know it. And I have always made it a point to do everything I can to get to know my students, because I really believe that if we get to operate on a first name basis, that it kind of closes the gap between instructor and student and makes the whole instructional experience more effective. And David Brooks was validating that in this particular article. The point I'm trying to make is that when you look at the LA teachers strike, and they're talking about class size and the fact that they want the system to hire more instructors, create more classes, and reduce average class size, this is really an important factor. I know that from my years of teaching. And so it's very obvious that that kind of an issue to these teachers is probably as important, if not more important, than a salary increase. They want the system to expend more funds to hire inadequate numbers of instructors as well as support staff and guidance counselors in order to try to make the educational experience for students better. That's what teaching is about. And the fact that these teachers are willing to go on strike for this kind of an objective or goal, I think is worthy. It's not something that I'm inclined to criticize at all. And then there's one more factor that's associated with that strike, and it's the issue of charter schools. And the teachers are concerned that the system within the LA system itself, a number of charter schools have opened, and they're funded with public money, which is being taken from the public schools in order to support these charter schools. And of course, the major difference with charter schools is that they have the freedom to be selective with the students they admit. They don't have to take the students that need a lot of time and a lot of special help. They are able to screen their students. And the result is the students that the charter schools don't want are required or given no choice except to the public school. And so the more charter schools there are, they are drawing off the best students from the public schools, and they're making the educational experience in the public schools much more difficult and much less effective. Because increasingly the teachers that teachers, public school teachers teach, are students that charter schools don't want. And so basically, these teachers believe that these charter schools are draining revenue from the public school educational experience. And it's creating a system within a system, as it were, which is free to discriminate on the students that they accept. And so the teachers are very concerned about that as well. So as I've read about the teacher strike, I've become pretty convinced that all in all, these teachers are after some things that are worth fighting for. And I wanted to make that comment as well. I'm guessing that a lot of people who tuned into yesterday's program at the Virtual Center may have been surprised, because I don't think I've made it a secret over the years that I'm a big New England Patriots sports fan. And I obviously was more than elated on Sunday evening by the results of the game. I'm not going into, who won, who lost, but obviously the fact that Kansas City was such a huge favorite in this game. I myself believed that the Patriots would really be hard pressed to have a chance to stand up against this team, but they did and they prevailed. And needless to say, I was thrilled. I remember, it was a couple of nights ago, obviously, but because I was watching TV, my wife was upstairs watching something else on TV. And when the game ended and the Patriots won it in overtime, I let out a scream of excitement that scared my wife. She came downstairs, "Well, what's wrong? What's wrong?" And I said, they won. Can you believe they won this damn game? I was absolutely thrilled. So I'm kind of thinking, after yesterday's program, it dawned on me, I'm sure that a couple of people at least were wondering why I didn't mention that particular game. Well, I'm going to mention a little bit now, because some issues have surfaced over the two playoff games that were played Sunday. The earlier game was from New Orleans, between the New Orleans Saints and the Los Angeles Rams. It also went into overtime. But the big issue, the issue that's getting all the attention in that game, was a missed pass interference call. An obvious pass interference call that even the referees themselves admit was a mistake. It should have been called. If it had been called, chances are more than likely that the New Orleans Saints would have won that game. It was well into the fourth period when it happened. New Orleans could have won the game with a field goal. They were very, very close. They were within field goal range. And the pass interference call that the referees didn't make was on fourth down, which meant that the ball went over to the Rams, and then the Rams went on to tie the game, to tie New Orleans, move the game into overtime, and then the Rams won it in overtime. If the refs had called this penalty, as they admit, it should have been called. Even the Rams player who committed the offense admitted that he had committed pass interference. If it had been called, it would have been an automatic first down for the Saints, for New Orleans. They could have run out the clock until the very end and kicked a gimme field goal and won the game. So now there's a big debate going on as to whether pass interference calls ought to be reviewable through technology, through the videotape. And the debate is focusing on the more reviews there are, that slows the game down. It slows motivation, interferes with motivation, and makes the game a lot less attractive for viewers who are waiting for these decisions to be made. Well, it turns out that there's a debate, not quite the same debate, about the New England-Kansas City game as well. The Patriots won that game in overtime. The game was tied at the end of regulation time, and then there's a coin flip, and the Patriots won that coin toss and elected to receive the ball. And the way the NFL rules for overtime are written, the team that wins the toss and gets the ball can win the game if they score a touchdown on their first drive. If they get less than a touchdown, in other words, they don't score at all, or they only get a field goal, the other team has a chance to respond. And if it's a field goal, the other team has an opportunity to get the ball coming the other way. And if they kick a field goal, it remains tied. But if they score a touchdown, then they win. So the reality was in this game that because the Patriots scored a touchdown in the first possession of the overtime, Kansas City never had a chance to get its hands on the ball in the overtime. And a lot of people now are talking about changing the rules, that there's something wrong with the rule. And I have to acknowledge I have a prejudice here. I'm a New England Patriots fan. I admit that. But the fact that many people want to change the rules because they believe it wasn't fair that Kansas City never had a chance to respond in the overtime. The thing that occurs to me is, would they be saying the same thing if Kansas City had won the toss and got the ball and scored on the first possession? And the answer to that question is probably not. And it ties in to the bias around the country against New England because they win. They've won consistently for so many years. This is the ninth, AFC championship that the Patriots had been in. So, it's very obvious that that a lot of people want them to lose. And that seems to be in part driving the debate over changing the rules on overtime. So I just wanted to make that. I think that's because millions of people watched that. It was the highest rated, one of the highest rated playoff games in terms of TV audience. So a lot of people watched it. A lot of people have opinions on this. So I wanted to at least mention that and mention the fact that a lot of people go to change the rules if the results of the game aren't as they wished they were. But anyway, that's the second item that I wanted to mention today. A third item. And I never mentioned that. I could have mentioned this last week because it really surfaced last week. But I really didn't think it was that important because I never really thought it was going to go anywhere. But it is going somewhere. And that is, here in West Virginia specifically, in the West Virginia legislature, which is controlled by Republicans, three members of the West Virginia legislature responding to the shutdown on the national level and responding to the, you know, from the perspective that West Virginia is a major supporter of President Trump. In 2016, President Trump won the state of West Virginia by 42%. All of this is to say that three Republican members of the West Virginia legislature have introduced or are introducing legislation which would take $10 million in taxpayer money from the state surplus and send it to President Trump for his wall. When I first read about that, I kind of laughed because it dawned on me this isn't going to go anywhere. But the fact of the matter is it is. It's getting a lot of support here because a lot of people in West Virginia apparently do support President Trump's position on the wall and do support President Trump's position on the shutdown and his determination to hold out against Nancy Pelosi and the Democrats. Well, the fact of the matter is, and I've already contacted my representative in the state legislature to this effect, that I believe, and I don't, it's not only a matter of what I believe, I think there's some legal basis for this as well, that this would violate my rights as a taxpayer. It would basically take my money and use it to make a political donation to a cause that I don't support. I don't mean to make this personal with the continuous use of the word I, but the fact of the matter is, at the end of the last Supreme Court session, the last decision of the Supreme Court in which John Paul Stevens was one of the justices before he retired, the last case that he gave an opinion on, which was in this past June of 2018, was the Janus case. Janus versus the Public School Union. And I know we spent time on that case when it was first decided. I know I did. But let me refresh your memory. In the Janus case, the issue was the right of unions, in this case, the Public Employees Union, American Federation of Municipal, County, and State Employees, I believe is the exact title. The case involved the right of the union to collect what is called an agency fee from non-members in order to compensate the union for representing their interests in negotiations. Let me be more specific or try to explain that. Even though employees, public employees, have the right to choose or decide whether they will become union members or not, and even though a public employee decides that he doesn't want to be a union member and therefore is not paying union dues, the fact of the matter is the union must still represent him. If the union negotiates with the employer and is successful in securing a pay raise for public employees, the union members get that pay raise, but so do the non-members. So in effect, even though an employee chooses to not be a member of the union, his interests are being represented by the union anyway. And going all the way back into the 1970s, the Supreme Court, this was in a case involving Detroit public school teachers, in the 1970s, the Supreme Court upheld the right of public sector unions to collect an agency fee from non-members to compensate the union for representing their interests. The Janus case overturned that previous Supreme Court decision and ruled that unions, public sector unions, can no longer demand an agency fee from non-members because it violates the First Amendment freedoms of non-members. In other words, if people choose, public employees choose, to not become members of the union, then they shouldn't have, according to the Supreme Court, their money taken through agency fees and used to benefit the political interests of the unions. And the conservative majority on the court, 5-4, ruled, and Stevens was one of the majority, that the agency fee, the requirement to pay an agency fee for non-union members, violated the First Amendment rights of these members because it was taking their money from them and using it for a political cause that they didn't support. I'm suggesting that if the Republican majority in the West Virginia legislature is successful in taking $10 million of tax money and giving it to President Trump for his wall, then they are doing the same thing to me, violating my First Amendment rights, as unions would be doing by collecting an agency fee, which was ruled unconstitutional in the Janus case. I made that case to my representative in the legislature. But since he's a Democrat, he's going to be in the minority. So this could pass anyway. And if it's contested or challenged or appealed, it could end up before the Supreme Court. A Supreme Court with a 5-4 conservative majority, that majority strengthened by the appointment last year of Brett Kavanaugh and the year before of Neil Gorsuch. I believe that this particular West Virginia law to contribute public money to the support of President Trump's wall on the border contradicts the ruling of the Supreme Court in Janus, because the situations are similar. And the reason I mentioned this on today's program is because I think it important that all of us watch the outcome as to what happens with this particular piece of legislation, because I think it's very, very important. I'm also concerned about the shutdown and the fact that neither side seems to be talking. There seems to be an impasse, and President Trump even made mention of the fact that this shutdown could go on for as long as a year. Obviously, public employees who are being required to work without pay cannot be expected to do that for a full year. So it's hard to believe that this thing could drag on that long. But we'll see. But I do believe that this West Virginia law to put $10 million in the coffers of President Trump and his supporters in order to help build the so-called wall on the southern border is a piece of legislation all of us need to keep an eye on. And then finally, and these, you know, these are the small issues. Then I've got a couple of large ones as well. But this is the fourth issue that I wanted to bring to your attention today in this our first hour. And it relates specifically to yesterday's program. In fact, the fifth issue, which is a little bit bigger, a little bit more complicated, will relate to yesterday's program as well. But I think it'll probably be toward the end of this hour or into our second hour before we get to that. But let me deal with this one first. You'll remember that yesterday in our program, we were talking about the issue of institutions. Specifically, we were talking about corporations as being legal persons and recognizing that corporations are economic institutions that have been given legal status as persons by the courts over the years, going all the way back to John Marshall. In fact, one of the things that I believe we addressed yesterday was the idea of a corporation being incorporated by government because the corporation brought something to the public interest or the public good that would not be available to citizens unless the corporation were allowed to deliver or provide that service or that product, whatever it might be. So that, in a sense, this was our position we looked at yesterday. What that means is that even though corporations are private sector entities or institutions, they are directly connected to the public interest or to service the public good, because their very creation, their very existence, is approved or given by government because they promise to provide a service to citizens of the community which would not be available were it not for this particular corporation. That means that the corporation is linked or connected to the public good. There is a public right of oversight. And John Marshall, going all the way back into the 1820s, affirmed, actually earlier than the 1820s, 1819, in the case of Dartmouth College versus Woodward, when John Marshall addressed the issue of corporations being legal persons. Marshall made the point very clearly that corporations are connected to and in a sense responsible to the public interest. That means that government does or is entitled to a degree of oversight. Regulation, but very carefully limited regulation. Because Marshall makes the point that these corporations are private sector entities, and therefore too much government regulation and interference in the ability of the corporation to function would jeopardize and inhibit the corporation's efforts to meet its public responsibilities, to deliver the service or the product for which it was originally incorporated. So in other words, Marshall walks a very, very thin line here between the freedom of the corporation to control its own internal operations and the public aspect of the corporation's existence, which is to provide the service which was the justification for its incorporation in the first place. So the decision, the Dartmouth College Woodward decision, and of course in this decision specifically, I won't get into this now, but the court is arguing that Dartmouth College was created as a private corporation. And those who contributed to the founding of Dartmouth College did so and received a charter from the King of England even before independence to provide a service in what was then the colony of New Hampshire, which was to provide educational services to Native Americans. And that even though the War for Independence happened, and even though the king, after the War of Independence was over, the king no longer controlled the colonies, that did not obliterate or vitiate the existence of Dartmouth College as a private institution. And when the state of New Hampshire, after independence, tried to take control of Dartmouth College and make it a public institution, the college went to court and was represented by Daniel Webster, who was a graduate of Dartmouth College. And the court ruled that the original charter granted by the king was, in effect, a contract. And that for the state of New Hampshire to vitiate that contract by making Dartmouth College a public institution was in effect a violation of the Constitution of the United States. It was a violation of the contract clause in the Constitution of the United States. When we covered this here in the virtual center before, I was going to say in class, when we covered this before, I believe I made the point, I'll make it again, that most people who look at or make reference to the Dartmouth College case emphasize the idea of the contract clause, emphasize the fact that Marshall used the contract clause to uphold the initial charter, the granting of Dartmouth College as the right to exist as a private corporation. But if you read the decision that Marshall wrote in defense of the court's decision at this time, you find that the bulk of the decision, the bulk of Marshall's opinion, does not focus on the contract clause at all. It focuses on the rights of corporations, and it seeks to distinguish or delineate the freedom of the corporation to function and operate without government interference, as opposed to government's right to establish a very limited sphere of regulation of the corporation in order to ensure that the corporation meets the responsibilities for which it was originally created. So the issue is the issue of corporations as private entities or private institutions. And that's what we were talking about yesterday. And the point that I wanted to make today in returning to this issue is to focus more specifically on the idea of institutions. Because the point I was trying to make yesterday was that just as Marshall acknowledged that government did have limited, restricted rights to oversee the behavior of corporations which were initially incorporated to serve the public, because government represents the public. And if the corporation was created and chartered to serve that public, then obviously the public has a right to evaluate the quality of services it's receiving from that corporation, which translates into the fact that if the public has that right, then as the representative of the public, government has that right. And my point was that corporations do have a certain responsibility to the public interest. If they didn't, they never would have been chartered in the first place or incorporated in the first place. But what I pointed out yesterday was that private corporations, and I also mentioned public institutions of higher education as well, are inclined over time to change their focus. Whereas public institutions or public corporations, as it were created to provide a public service or deliver a service or a product for the public good. Over time, invariably it happens that the issues of ends and means become reversed. That it seems almost inevitable that institutions created to serve the public become institutions committed after a while to serving their own interests first. And instead of being institutions to provide a public service, means to an end, institutions begin to make policy designed to benefit the institution itself. In other words, the survival of the institution in the face of changing conditions almost naturally becomes the priority of these organizations or these institutions. The reason I wanted to go back to this today was because I wanted to share with you a little bit more perspective or insight on the nature of institutions. And I'm struck particularly by an article, which this goes way back 50 years ago. But in the first years that I was teaching in college, I began to use this study, this article, in my freshman world history classes. And I totally forgot about it when we covered this issue yesterday. And I wanted to revisit it in order to share this with you today. The article I'm referring to is an article by a historian named Carl Gustafsson. Gustafsson is Swedish. G-U-S-T-A-V-S-O-N. Gustafsson. And Gustafsson writes on the history and development of the Roman Catholic Church in Europe. And he uses this history of the church as an illustration of the innate idea of institutions reversing ends and means over time. He points out that from the beginning, the church was created theoretically to assist in the salvation of souls. The Catholic Church preached that God so loved mankind that he created the church to provide the special graces necessary to help individual sinners achieve heaven, achieve salvation, through the sacraments, through the special graces or indulgences awarded by the church. Individual souls who abided by the teachings of the church would receive from the church the special graces necessary to ensure their salvation in heaven for all eternity. And the church's teaching was that the church was initially created by Jesus, by God, in order to assist mankind in his efforts to achieve salvation. The first pope of the church was Saint Peter. And this whole institution was created by God for purposes of helping man achieve salvation. But that over time, as you look at the history of the church, and you look at various examples of groups of people attacking the church and attacking the secular power of the church, the church was forced to defend itself against these attacks. And ultimately, the church's number one priority became salvation of the church, not the salvation of the souls who belong to that church. In other words, the church began to put its own self-interest, its own institutional priorities, ahead of the purposes for which that institution was originally created. There's a total reversal of ends and means. And Carl Gustafsson tells this story. But his conclusion is that institutions, by their very existence, are inclined over time to transfer means to an end. In other words, the church ceases to be the means to the salvation of believers and becomes an institution committed principally to its own existence and its own self-interest and protection. And the rationale for that, of course, is that the church's argument is, if we don't survive, we can't fulfill the mission for which we were initially created. So our own priorities, our own self-interest, needs to be our number one priority. Colleges and universities do the same thing as institutions. Their argument is, we are created and publicly funded to provide an educational service to students. We have to do whatever we feel we have to do to protect ourselves and to protect the viability of the institution in order to provide that service. And suddenly, what was initially a public interest, which caused the creation of the institution, becomes self-interest. Gustafsson's conclusion is that this is inherent in institutions. It's natural. It always happens. So the question is, is there a way to prevent it? Gustafsson says no. But the fact of the matter is, through public regulation, through public oversight, there is a way to ensure that the public interest for which the institution was initially created remains the ultimate objective, the end, if you will, of the institution's priorities. In other words, institutions naturally shift to look to their own self-interest as opposed to the public interest. And the only way that process can be checked is by public oversight. The insistence of the public that the institution continue to provide the services for which it was initially created and for which it was initially funded. In higher education's case, taxpayers are seeing their tax money going to the support of colleges and universities because they believe that the existence and the viability of public universities is a public good, that the entire state benefits from the existence of that institution. But only public oversight can make sure that the institution doesn't allow self-interest to take precedence over the operation and the policy development within that institution. I wanted to add this idea of the innate institutional tendency to substitute means and ends, or reverse means and ends, and specifically to make reference to Carl Gustafson's study on the history of the church as evidence of this. Because I think if you've taken, and I know many of you have, sociology classes, you probably have run into the issue of institutions. The whole idea that organized societies, by definition, create institutions in order to serve the public interest. I think it's important to recognize that this commitment to serve the public interest, if not checked, will over time become self-interest, and the public interest will tend to be pushed toward the back burner unless public oversight keeps that from happening. Those are four of the issues that I wanted to address here in our first hour. I've got a couple of more complicated issues that I'd like to address in our second hour. But right now, we're 1 minute beyond the top of the hour, so I almost did it. I almost hit it perfectly. I'd like to pause and take a five-minute break and then begin our second hour here on this Tuesday edition of the Ritual Center. So again, I hope that you'll stay with us. We're going to take a short break. We'll be right back. Thank you.
We now return to the Virtual Center for the Study of the Constitution and Civic Responsibility. Here's your host, our own Dr. Bill O'Brien.
Thank you, Agnes, and welcome to the second hour of today's edition of the Virtual Center for Study of the Constitution and Civic Responsibility. Again, today is the 22nd day of January in the year 2019. If you are just joining us, we welcome you to today's program. If you've been with us through the first hour, first, I want to thank you for staying with us. And second, I want to apologize for the complexity of the first hour. The fact is, in the first hour, we covered four different topics. I don't think I've ever tried to do that before. And I find that shifting from topic to topic, it's probably creating a little bit of confusion on the part of some of our, for some of our listeners. I hope that doesn't happen. But I think each of these issues is important. In this hour, there are two issues that I'd like to deal with. One of them relates to yesterday's program, more specifically to one Mitch McConnell. And the second one deals with higher education or education generally. And it's kind of a follow-up to the programs that we've done in the last couple of weeks on education. So I really believe that these two topics will probably take much, most, all, if you will, of our second hour. So again, if you've been with us through the first hour and you're still with us, hats off to you. You're a hero because I didn't lose you. And I hope I didn't, because I really believe, I really think that that question of institutionalism is particularly significant. I also think that the issue of taking $10 million of public tax money from a state, from the state coffers, and contributing to President Trump so he can build his wall, and whether in fact that is even legal, I think that's an important issue as well. If you'd like to comment on any of those issues or comment on other issues that you feel are important to our listeners, then by all means, please know that you are welcome. We have two phone numbers that will get you into our Head On Radio Network studios, and Agnes will get you on the air. If you call either one of two numbers, both of them have the same area code, 304. The first one is 304-574-8178. 304-574-8178. The second number, same area code, 304-640-2829. 304-640-2829. Or you can email me directly at waobrien906@gmail.com. Or you can communicate directly with me through our Facebook page. Just go to facebook.com, and in the search box at the top of the homepage, type in the Virtual Center for Study of the Constitution, and you'll be onto our Facebook page. And if you go to one of the postings there, at the end of each posting, you'll see a comment box or comment link as well as a share link. If you click on the comment link, that gives you the opportunity to communicate directly with me. It can be about that particular posting, but it doesn't have to be. It can be generally related to issues on the program. Since I get the comment directly, it's a good way for you to communicate directly with me if there's something you would like to say about the program or about some of the issues that we cover here on the Virtual Center. So with that, let me get into what is in reality our fifth topic on today's program. I envision six. And this is the fifth one. And it relates to yesterday's program when we went into quite a bit of detail on Mitch McConnell. More specifically, on the relationship between Mitch McConnell and his wife, Elaine Chao, and the Chao family, which is based in Shanghai. And the fact that Mitch McConnell's ability to become a millionaire many times over is clearly related to his February 1993 marriage to Elaine Chao. And we spent a lot of time yesterday on the Chao family and on the role of Mitch McConnell and what financial benefits Mitch McConnell has personally and his Republican the Republican members of the Senate he controls have gained from Mitch McConnell's private connections to the Chao family. Elaine Chao's father, James Chao, is a shipbuilder based in Shanghai, and he has made contacts with some of the most influential political leaders and financial leaders in modern China. And the result is that many financial dealings, private, corporate, institutional dealings between agencies and banks in China have created become involved in partnerships with like institutions in contemporary Russia. And so as we see the ongoing Mueller investigation, the special counsel investigation into President Trump and the Russian connection, which he continually insists there is no collusion and all of that. We won't get into that specifically. But the point that I wanted to make yesterday was that Mitch McConnell and the position that Mitch McConnell takes on many of these issues is better understood, in part at least, by being aware of this background that McConnell has. His sister-in-law, Angela Chao, sits on the board of the Bank of China. And as we know, for example, the Bank of China has a suite of offices in Trump Tower in Manhattan. We also know that the Bank of China in 2014 entered into a partnership with the state bank in Russia, which is in part controlled by Vladimir Putin. And that once this partnership was consummated, the Bank of China made a $37.5 million loan to James Chao and his shipbuilding company in Shanghai. And private interests in China, corporate interests in China, as well as Russia, began to pour money into the coffers managed by Mitch McConnell. More specifically, his Senate Leadership Fund, which was a fund created and managed by him to help Republican senators get reelected by supporting their campaign with major contributions. And of course, we've been privy every day to the stories about President Trump's effort to get a Trump Tower in Moscow and the likely interactions and relationships between President Trump, his business interests, and his his election campaign from 2016 to be involved with Russian oligarchs who were making major contributions into his election, his defeat of Hillary Clinton. So the fact of the matter is there's a very complex interrelationship going on here amongst all of these interests. And the fact that Mitch McConnell has been so outspoken in his unwillingness to get involved in the shutdown and his statement that he refuses to bring any bill to the floor of the United States Senate that President Trump will not sign has in effect surrendered the independence and the oversight responsibilities of the Senate to the control of President Trump, who's supposed to be the recipient of Senate oversight under the separation of powers and checks and balances. And Mitch McConnell's continued insistence that he really doesn't have anything to contribute to resolving the shutdown issue over the wall, and that this is something that's going to have to be worked out between the president and Democrats. His efforts publicly to distance himself from this particular issue is a bit evasive, a bit duplicitous, it seems to me, on McConnell's part. Because McConnell, clearly, because of his financial connections and the family connections through his wife, seems to be, to me, to be much more involved in what's going on at the international level than Mitch McConnell has ever publicly owned up to. In fact, I was struck just yesterday by the fact that a reporter asked Mitch McConnell a question about something about his wife, because his wife holds a cabinet position in the Trump administration. She's Secretary of Transportation. And this question directly pertained to her. And Mitch McConnell reacted very, very negatively to this and refused to respond. And it was very clear he doesn't want his wife brought into any of this discussion. But the reality is, once you bring his wife into the picture, then automatically what comes with that is Mitch McConnell's financial connections and the contributions he's receiving from Russian oligarchs as well as Chinese business interests. There's an intricate international web here. And while the special counsel is collecting evidence in order to make a determination as to whether President Trump is directly involved in this international web, so far, Mitch McConnell's potential or possible role in that has pretty much been overlooked. But I would suggest that there's a lot here that hasn't been yet addressed. There's a lot of attention. In fact, there are a couple of lawsuits in the hopper already related to the degree to which President Trump might be guilty of violations of the emoluments clauses, there are two, in the Constitution. That in effect, he might be conducting public business, political business, in the name of the country, primarily to promote his own private business interests. Particularly, this revolves around the Trump International Hotel in Washington. And the fact that a number of foreign dignitaries are paying exorbitant hotel rates to stay there in order to gain access to the White House. And there's all sorts of evidences of conflict of interest, potential conflict of interest involving President Trump. So far, nothing related to conflict of interest has been mentioned publicly, which relates to Mitch McConnell. But I would suggest that the situation, the circumstances are such that there are questions which surface about whether, in fact, Mitch McConnell has encountered issues related to emoluments as well. The millions of dollars that the Bank of China contributed to Mitch McConnell's Senate Leadership Fund. The millions of dollars that the Russian oligarch Blavatnik has contributed to the senatorial leadership fund, McConnell's leadership fund. And the fact that a $54 million contributed by Blatnik alone to the leadership fund, $1.6 million of that has gone directly into Mitch McConnell's personal campaign coffers. Received an email this morning from one of our listeners who said that he was appreciative of the fact that not only here at the Virtual Center, but Bob Kincaid as well, are also addressing Mitch McConnell's involvement in this whole thing. That we're going behind the scenes, we're moving the curtain back a little bit, and taking a look at some of the connections, financial as well as political, that might involve Mitch McConnell directly in some of this. And he was grateful for that, and his point was nobody else is doing it. The fact of the matter is, it's critical. And the article that I got much of this information from yesterday is an article that you can get yourself by going to the Daily Kos, K-O-S, online. There's obviously no definitive evidence there, but the circumstantial evidence is incredible. And the situation is such that there's all sorts of potential for emoluments violations and all the rest of it. Mitch McConnell, no question, is much more involved in some of these issues which heretofore seem to involve only the White House. And it seems to me pretty clear that many of the political positions taken by McConnell and his ability to control the Senate in many of these areas are directly related to some of the personal involvements and financial connections that Ms. McConnell has become involved in over the years, principally, it seems to me, through his relationship with the Chow family, with James Chow, Elaine's father, and the political contributions that have come his way as a result of this familial connection that he has to the Chow family. So I think all of that is worthy of attention and something that is well worth keeping our eye on. Let me take this one step further. And this we didn't get into yesterday. But let me share with you a thought, you know, something that I thought was really worth mentioning on today's program. This morning, in conversations in the media about the shutdown, about the ongoing shutdown, and about the impasse between the House and the Senate, the impasse that principally involves Nancy Pelosi and Donald Trump, one of the commentators that I happened to see was a name that all of us are familiar with because he retired from NBC News some years ago, Tom Brokaw. Tom Brokaw was on one of the network panel discussions this morning, and he was talking about the relationship between Mitch McConnell and Donald Trump, between the presidency and Congress, between McConnell's role as majority leader in the Senate and the positions being taken by the White House, by the Trump administration. And he used a term to describe McConnell's behavior that I picked up on, and I did some further investigation of it and some analysis of it this morning before we went on the air. Specifically, Tom Brokaw made mention of the fact that in his relationship with Donald Trump, with President Trump, Mitch McConnell seems to be assuming the role of prime minister. That in effect, President Trump has created a relationship with Mitch McConnell, and Mitch McConnell is going along with it, wherein Mitch McConnell has become almost, in the eyes of President Trump, what we know to be called a prime minister, who is managing or controlling Congress by keeping bills off the floor or refusing to put bills passed by the House on the floor. And we know that the new democratically controlled House of Representatives has already passed a number of bills intended to open many of the agencies that are currently shut down. And the Democrats, Nancy Pelosi, is insisting that before Democrats participate in negotiations over border security, the Democrats are insisting that government be reopened, that the shutdown end. And in support of that, the Democrats controlling the House have passed legislation and sent it on to the Senate, which would open all of those government agencies currently on strike, not associated with funding Homeland Security, which directly is connected to border security. And Mitch McConnell refuses to allow any of those bills to come to the floor of the Senate. On the other hand, McConnell has committed to bringing to the floor President Trump's compromise position from last Saturday afternoon in his national press conference, or national address to the nation, Saturday afternoon at 3 p.m., in which he basically made what he believed was a concession that the Democrats ought to take, that he was willing to provide 3 years of security to the so-called Dreamers, to extend DACA protection for these children of people that came into this country illegally for 3 more years in exchange for the $5.7 billion he wants for the wall. And as we mentioned yesterday, Nancy Pelosi rejected the president's offer out of hand. She called it a non-starter and responded by insisting that the government be reopened before any negotiations take place. And, of course, also involved in this is the fact that President Trump made this concession, so-called, without any impact, any input from the Democrats. In other words, this was not something that the Democrats participated in. This was totally President Trump and his advisors in the White House came up with this. In other words, they are suggesting this compromise almost from the top down, which contributes to this idea that Mitch McConnell almost seems to be, in the mind of Tom Brokaw, playing the role of prime minister, controlling Congress in the interests of the administration. And what this struck in my mind was a little bit, was almost the idea that we really ought to go into a little bit more detail, a little bit more analysis on what the difference between the president and a prime minister involves. Specifically, the major difference between our form of government, our representative form of government, and those forms of government which we would call parliamentary systems, those systems which do have a prime minister, what is the difference between them and what we're dealing with here? In what ways is Mitch McConnell acting like a prime minister? And in what ways is that analogy not accurate? And it seems to me that in order to answer that question, we need to look at some of the major characteristics of a parliamentary form of government, recognizing that that is exactly what we do not have here in this country. Using Great Britain as the principal example here, we have seen the operations recently because of the Brexit situation in the UK that the current Prime Minister, Theresa May, just this past week was able to withstand a vote of no confidence over Brexit. And what I'm asking us to think about is, in the UK, the relationship between the Prime Minister and the Queen. Because in Great Britain, the Queen, the Crown, in this case, Queen Elizabeth, is the executive, and Parliament is the legislative branch. And just as our legislative branch is divided between the House of Representatives and the Senate, so Parliament is divided between the House of Commons and the House of Lords. But the key factor here is that in the UK, primary power, political power, is wielded not by the Queen, but by the Prime Minister. In England, the Crown has been reduced to more the role of a figurehead, a symbol, than a political force. The Prime Minister wields the power. And the Prime Minister's principal job is to recommend or make policy and get it through the Parliament. That's the parliamentary form of government. Part of the Prime Minister's job in managing and marshaling legislation or policy through a divided parliament is made more difficult because of the party situation in Great Britain and other parliamentary systems. Unlike our situation, Great Britain does not just have two parties. Great Britain and the others are multi-party systems, to the point that more often than not, no one party has a majority of the parliament. So one party doesn't make the rules. The challenge to the prime minister is to create or establish coalitions among different parties. The only way that the prime minister can create a majority is to fashion coalition agreements between two or more of the parties within that parliament. The benefit of a multi-party system is that it offers every voter something very specific. Rather than the voter having to choose between A and B, the number of choices, party choices, that a voter has is much greater in a parliamentary system. So if you are conservative, if you are extremely conservative, if you are middle of the road, if you tend a little bit left of center, a little bit more liberal, or you tend to be much more extremely liberal, there's a party for you. But the result of that multi-party system is that no one party controls parliament, which means that the prime minister cannot govern unless coalitions are created and these coalitions are maintained. It forces the different parties to negotiate and create compromise amongst themselves in order to create a government that can function by controlling a majority. And that's the principal challenge of the prime minister. The crown is not anywhere in this picture. The only thing that politically that the crown does is call for a new election if there's a vote of no confidence in the prime minister. If it looks like parliament is disintegrating to such a degree that government can no longer function, at that point, the crown calls for a new election. And theoretically, that could produce a new prime minister and the need to create new coalitions. Last week, Theresa May was able to withstand such a vote of no confidence. What about our system? Our system is based, like Great Britain's, on separation of powers, executive, legislative, and judicial. We have a specific independent judicial branch. Parliament's judiciary is embedded within Parliament itself, connected most directly to the House of Lords. And the British Constitution, unlike ours, is not a written constitution that can be interpreted by a court. Britain's Constitution is based on common law and tradition and precedent, and is constantly being reinterpreted by judicial spokesmen within the House of Lords, principally. The whole idea of our separation of separation of powers system in our political system is based on the principle of checks and balances as built into the Constitution. The role of Congress, the role of the Senate and the House, is to check the executive. But under Article 2 of the Constitution, the president, the executive branch, is given specific powers in our system. That's a major difference from a parliamentary system. In the parliamentary system, political power is lodged in the legislative branch, and the executive branch, theoretically, plays no major role. Another major difference from our political system and the parliamentary system is the nature of parties. Whereas parliamentary systems tend to have multi-parties, which govern by coalition, our system is comprised principally of two major parties, occasionally joined by third parties. We have a Green Party, Mountain Party, these other parties, none of which have a chance of winning control of government, of getting a president elected. There have been third parties throughout American history, but mostly these third parties are able to influence the major parties. If a third party is garnering too much popularity, too much political support from the electorate, from the voters, then what happens is that the two major parties are forced to make concessions to what the third party stands for in order to gain that political support, those political votes. So our system, from the very beginning, has functioned on the basis of two parties. Why? Because this country faced a challenge that Great Britain or other nations of Europe don't face. And that is the fact of multinationalism, pluralism, that our population is comprised of so many different national groups, racial groups, religious groups, etc., that the major threat to our political system is division. And the founders believed that it was necessary to find a way to somehow bring these divisions together, to find a way to make our government work within a pluralistic society. And our two-party system serves that purpose. If only one of two parties can win control of government, then that forces people to choose one or the other if they want to have any impact at all on policy. And the fact that only one or the other of the two parties can win, that means that a pluralistic, divided society must come together in order to conduct elections, campaigns successfully. How is it that two-party systems continue to exist? How are they maintained? They are maintained by the winner-take-all system in our state elections. And what that means is the party that wins the majority in the state gets all the electoral votes for president. There's no effort to divide up proportionally the votes. In a parliamentary system, when election is held, the various parties get the proportion of representation that the voters gave it. In other words, if the Conservative Party gets 30% of the vote, the Labour Party gets 25% of the vote, the extreme right party gets another 15% of the vote, and an extreme left party, Socialist Party, for example, gets 20% of the vote, then each of those parties is allocated the number of representatives proportional to the vote they received. But in our elections, the party that wins the vote in the state level gets all the electoral votes. So that fact alone means that only the two major parties can elect a president. And the idea is that under the checks and balances system, Congress has a responsibility to check the excesses of the presidency of the executive. That's what makes this behavior of Mitch McConnell suspect, because he has surrendered the oversight powers of the Senate to the control of Donald Trump. He's given the executive branch control, effectively control over the legislative branch, which violates our whole political system. It almost is trending towards a parliamentary system. But a parliamentary system in this society cannot exist because the Constitution gives real political power to the executive. The only way that a parliamentary system can exist is when the executive has no meaningful political power, and all power is located within the legislative branch. Here it's divided. Therefore, parliamentary government cannot work. And that's why Tom Brokaw's comment about Mitch McConnell acting almost like a prime minister is important. Because within Congress, he's acting as if he was in total control, because he controls the majority. But in effect, in our system, the president seems to be almost in total control, because Mitch McConnell has sacrificed the oversight responsibilities of the Senate to the White House. So as complicated as this is, in one sense, Brokaw's right. McConnell's behavior does seem to create the idea of a prime minister. But in very substantive, real ways, that can't be true so long as the White House, the executive, has political power in our system. The only way that McConnell could really be a prime minister would be if he had control over the whole Congress and the president had no power at all. In other words, he had it all. And that ain't going to happen as long as we've got this Constitution. But it seems to me that's another question as to how long that's going to be. So this particular issue, it seems to me, is a critically important one as well. And I wanted to get to the last issue, but we've got less than 10 minutes left in our program, but I'm going to deal with it anyway. And it deals with higher education, and education generally. And we've been dealing with a lot of it recently. And if you remember, we cited Plato and we cited the Phaedrus in the Republic, and we've been making reference to the allegory of the cave in Plato's Republic. And we've been talking about education, whether education constitutes the introduction of knowledge from the outside into every individual student, or whether from Plato's point of view, true education, real education, should be an effort to develop the knowledge and skills already within the individual student. In other words, is the principal role of the teacher to deliver new information and call it education, or is education something different? Is education the result of the teacher's job in helping the student identify and hone the kinds of skills which enable the student to become a self-learner? Should teaching primarily be focused on teaching the student, the learner, how to learn more, so that the student controls his own education into the future for the rest of his life and is not totally dependent on some outside force giving them new information all the time, which they are charged with processing? In other words, is education a product, which is the introduction of new information, or is education a process, which is developing the skills that already exist within the student? We've been going back 2,400 years to Plato and Plato's Republic to address these questions. But I want to remind you of something that we dealt with before, some time ago, and that is that this question has come up in this country before, and it continues to be an issue which affects our education system. And what I'm talking about is the difference between the education of students to become self-learners, developing the ability to teach themselves, as it were, versus the idea of education being information that is relevant or useful. This debate continues to go on. The debate between the practical versus the impractical, the useful versus the useless. All of this is based on the idea that education is not student-focused, but that education is information or content-focused. Once you buy that education is information, then you are confronted with a decision: what information should be given the student? Benjamin Franklin, as early as 1747, wrote his proposals relating to the education of youth in Pennsylvania in light of this question. In other words, as early as 1747, 29 years before the Declaration of Independence, Franklin was responding to this call within the colony for education that was more useful, the introduction of information students needed in order to be successful in business in their lives, the distinction between useful education and what Franklin argued would be useless education, what we call today fluff. What Franklin referred to as the ornamental. His position was that there's too much information out there, useful and useless, for students to process it all. And that it's up to the institution to separate the important information, the useful information, from the ornamental. And Franklin says, unfortunately, most students don't have time to deal with the ornamental. They need to focus on only that information that they can use. Franklin said it would be well if they could be taught everything that's useful as well as everything that's ornamental. But he said, art is long and their time is short. In other words, these kids are not here long enough to handle all the information that's out there. We've got to make some choices. And Franklin's conclusion was that the only way to deal with this is to design instruction, design curriculum, according to the idea or the direction, the several professions for which students are intended. In other words, if students are going into business, if they're going to be entrepreneurs, if they're going to be professional business people, accountants, bookkeepers, salesmen, all the rest of it, then the instruction they should get should be instruction directed towards a career in business. And this became especially prominent after independence in the early 19th century, when the economy of this country was beginning to take off, when the economic future of this country seemed unlimited. Businesses and business type entrepreneurs began to put the pressure on schools to teach only the information that students needed, that students could use. And this question came up in 1828 at Yale University in New Haven. The proposal was that Yale drop the classics, foreign languages specifically, Latin and Greek, from its standard required curriculum for undergraduates. That since most students would never use Latin or Greek, then these people argued that it was a waste of time when they went to Yale to have to study it and learn these classical languages. What they propose is getting rid of these languages and substituting material that was much more useful to the students. And this proposal became a formal proposal and was presented to the faculty at Yale University. And the faculty responded. And the faculty responded with an approach to education which was much more consistent with what we saw in Plato and the allegory of the cave. I think we're going to have to postpone the rest of this story for another day because we have run out of time. I almost made it. I got 5 done, but I didn't get the 6th one. I ask you, first of all, remind you that we will not be doing a live program tomorrow. Our next time together will be next Monday at the beginning of a new week of broadcasting here at the Virtual Center. And we'll pick up on the Yale report of the Yale faculty of 1828 at that time. So if you'd like to prepare for next Monday's program, then you might go online and look up the Yale report, 1828, and you'll kind of get a head start on our next program. For Bob Kincaid and Agnes and the folks at Head On, and for me, Bill O'Brien, I want to thank you for your continued support of the program and of the network. I hope you have a great rest of this Tuesday and a great rest of this week. Please join us again when we come back, same time, same place, next Monday afternoon. Thank you. so very, very much.